The Media Project.
Hey there! Looking for the perfect place to take the family this year?
You bet I am. The family still hasn't forgiven me for telling them we were going to Six Flags, only to find out we were driving through the car wash and then going home.
Well, I have a suggestion.
Why should I listen to you?
Well, why not?
Good point.
Take the family to Buster Rhymes Island this year.
Buster Rhymes Island? Tell me more.
I was about to, you jerk.
Oh.
Located on Mill Pond in Shrewsbury, Massachusetts, Buster Rhymes Island has rope swinging, blueberries, and stuff Buster would enjoy.
Say, that sounds right up my street.
It is up your street, quite literally.
Oh.
Buster Rhymes Island is in no way affiliated with Buster Rhymes, but we could definitely see him digging it. Buster Rhymes Island is a real place. Go look it up on Wikipedia or Google Maps if you don't believe us. But you're just going to look like an idiot when you find out we were right and you were stupid. And coming soon, spring break on Buster Rhymes Island.
Excuse me, do you mind if I join you?
What were you saying?
As chairwoman of the reception committee, I welcome you with open arms.
Is that so? How late do you stay open?
Hello and welcome to the Mental Suppository. I'm Bret Herholtz, and joining me today
is Scott M. Graves.
And today we're going to be talking about comedies from way back when, mostly about politics and anti-fascism in movies.
Yeah, that's such a cordial and informal way to go through. I guess that you're not lying, right?
I'm not lying.
But we're really focusing in on which we feel is kind of prescient for our times, I guess.
It really is. And we're going to get into all of that.
We're focusing on anti-fascist movies.
And we'll get to that right after a word from our sponsor.
This week on Channel 58, watch an all-new episode of Outdoors is the Shit. Just like Duck Dynasty. We're exploiting the human dumpster fire known as rednecks.
Howdy, y'all. I'm Zeke, and welcome to a new episode of Outdoors is the Shit. My brothers Deke and Reed Deke couldn't join us because they're still recovering from last week's episode when we tried to prove you can make a Ford Pinto do jumps like the General Lee. Although the car exploded, we still feel the jury's out on that one. I'm out on the lake because this week we're going trout fishing. Most fellas will tell you the best way to catch them is with a good sturdy fishing pole. Anyone who tells you that is obviously a puss or a commie. I have found it's much easier to catch them with a good old 12-gauge shotgun. Normally about this time, they'd be floating to the surface. Unfortunately, I slipped and blew a hole in my boat and got a piece of it stuck in my scrotum. By the looks of it, I'm going to need a lot more than a pair of tweezers to get it out of there. So I gotta row myself back to shore before I sink and get myself looked at.
Don't miss the next episode of Outdoors is the Shit, only on Channel 58. Next week, find out what's the best way to prepare and cook a raccoon on your Hemi.
It's funny, I always felt like the most outspoken politically have always been comedians. They've also passionately about it. And the films we're talking about today all have like a different political aspect to them. Some of them in a little more than others. I think in the case of, say, like one of the films we're going to talk about, and it's a film, I don't know if it's as remembered as it is now. The Marx Brothers are as remembered as they were.
Yeah, right.
But it's turned out, I mean, at the time it wasn't a hit, and it was one of these films that it's become a success. It's become more of a, it's considered a classic nowadays than it was back then.
Yeah,
Duck
Soup is the film that you're talking about. It was a Marx Brothers film, which ended up, from what I understand, being the fifth film that they did for Paramount.
That's right.
And due to the results of the film, so you know, in preparing for today's episode, it's funny, I went through about a half dozen different sources to kind of figure out the history of the film itself.
Yeah.
And everyone had a slightly different perspective on how this film
did and the context of it when it came out, but it wasn't a complete financial flop, but no. It just wasn't a hit like their other films.
Yeah, especially like Animal Crackers or Horse Feathers, which were considered, you know, their biggest hits for Paramount.
Exactly. But due to the ongoing tensions in their relationship with Paramount, by the time the film was distributed and people were watching it in the theaters, you know, the Marx Brothers, pretty much that was the end of their relationship.
They were definitely done with Paramount. And the thing about the film that's interesting is, it's like I said, it's not overtly political because it doesn't attack a certain country. Right. It doesn't attack certain politics. You know, for all intents and purposes, it's really the same formula as a lot of their other films. And I actually have found over time, I've enjoyed the films they did with Paramount as the four Marx Brothers a lot more than the output they did for MGM. Because I think they were given a lot more freedom, and they had some really good writers working for them as well.
Yeah, we were talking about that just a moment ago off air, how at Paramount they were really allowed to be the Marx Brothers that everybody knows and loves, right. and the comedy was really driving the boat.
Exactly.
Which was not something that MGM generally, from what you were telling me, is not something they felt comfortable with in their
films. No, it really felt like that. I mean, it really felt like MGM felt like a movie really couldn't move forward without romantic leads.
Right.
Whereas with Duck Soup, you can definitely tell they're in the driver's seat. I mean, it's a movie, it stars the Marx Brothers. That one and Horse Feathers have always been my favorite of the Marx Brothers films. And this one, because I think it was like, you know, it was like the height of their absurdity.
Right.
I mean, they have a whole, if you know, for those who haven't watched the film, there's like a whole song and dance number when they're going to war.
Right, right. Well, you know, there's two points I want to make. One is to agree and reiterate with the point you made a moment ago, that this film, and we're going to see in other films that were a lot more overt, right?
Yeah.
So overt references to fascist dictators at
right.
that time through the visuals, right? Through the visuals of the movie, also through the dialogue of the movie and so forth. So they're satirical caricatures of people that were living. Duck Soup does none of that.
It's all in
the abstract. But then it's also the film 100%, whether or not you're really picking up on the topical political satire going on, it's a total Marx Brothers film, right? If you only watched three or four short clips of the movie, it's just their timing,
absolutely.
Their sense of comedy, right? Which
very verbal. They were made for the talkie era.
They were made for that era, and in a lot of ways, just setting the stage for all comedy,
oh,
stand-up comedy and film comedy for the next 100 years. I mean, you know, it's just like this. The dialogue is crazy, crazy funny, and it's just joke after joke after joke.
And for people who haven't seen the film, the whole plot is Groucho Marx's character, Rufus T. Firefly, becomes the president of this fictitious country, Fredonia, who's the former president's widow, played by the capable Margaret Dumont,
right.
You know, suggests her. And I think the Marx Brothers films that work the best is when they have Margaret Dumont, who's just like hopelessly in love with this shyster Groucho is playing.
That's right. That's right. Yeah. And in this case, he's on the make with her.
Oh, absolutely. Because she's rich.
Because she's rich. And she's Fredonia, this fictitious company.
Country.
Yeah. Fictitious country.
I did it too.
It has two problems, right? One is it's broke.
Exactly.
Right? Now, she's a widow, so they're trying to get her money. So you've got all of these people that really want to see that happen for the country. Groucho, of course, wants to, you know, he's on the make with her.
Absolutely.
Right? At the same time, the fictitious neighboring country, Sylvania.
Yeah, Sylvania, who's Ambassador Trentino, finds he's at a loggerhead with Groucho, because both of them want to get on the make with Mrs. Teasdale, played by Margaret Dumont.
That's right. And the two spies that are working for Sylvania, played by Groucho's brothers.
Harpo and Chico.
And from this, mild plot, it's just a whole series of one-liners, you know.
And aside from the political humor, there's also some really great scenes, and one of my favorite scenes has always been the lines between Groucho and Groucho's character in Margaret Dumont's, where he's like, not that I care, but where's your husband? Which she says, why, he's dead. And he's like, I bet he's just using that as an excuse.
That's right.
I was with him till the very end. Oh, no wonder he passed away.
That's right.
I held him in my arms and kissed him. Oh, I see. It was murder. Do you want to marry me? Did he leave you any money? Answer the second question first. Of course, he left her his entire fortune, which immediately Groucho falls in love with her,
right,
quote unquote.
Right. The dance scene, too, is another great scene from that movie.
Yeah.
You know, not just for the dancing itself, but it's just, the gags are just,
oh, absolutely,
spot on in this movie, right? You know, and but it's funny because,
and then his dealing with politics, like him in front of his cabinet and saying, you know, saying to his secretary, played by his younger brother Zeppo, you know, it's like, oh, a 4-year-old can read this. He goes, go find a 4-year-old. I can't make heads or tails of it.
Yeah, and that's where some of this satire comes in.
Yeah.
And so there are some satirical themes that sort of rifle through the entire movie. But
like you said, they're not overt.
It's not overt. They're not picking on Hitler. They're not picking on Mussolini.
Of course, deserve it.
You know, Franco.
Yeah.
Because the Spanish Civil War, is just getting started when when this movie comes out. But you know, in the gags, there's a lot of making fun of sort of the infantile and fragile egos leaders, of the fact that this country is really just doing all of this really kind of bad stuff behind the scenes.
Actually, that sets it up
for money.
Sets up for a great scene where Groucho is trying to get Trentino to slap him.
Right.
You know, so he can kick him out of the country, and Groucho slapping Trentino because he ends up calling him an upstart. He goes, that's it, upstart, and slaps him.
That's right. Well, and that's one of these examples, right, where like what they're portraying is one leader's sort of like false flag for going to war. Because if they go to war, right, number one, we're going to make all this money. Number two, it's almost like the whole ridiculous nature of the moment and the premise for doing something, which is ultimately going to be really bad, they're in that way, you know, they're for the people that are watching the movie that would have been hip to things, world affairs and so forth at that time in 1933, would be watching this and saying, oh, it's like Franco and the Republicans, it's like what Mussolini did to take over his country, and then ultimately, you know, because the movie comes out in 1933, and this is the year that at the beginning of the year, Hitler is made chancellor, sort of to appease the Nazis. And both conservatives and liberals and communists within Germany thought that this would be a way to do two things, right?
Oh.
One, they'd be able to create a coalition government where they can kind of isolate the Nazis by making him chancellor, but then taking over all of the other portfolios.
Yeah,
all
how did
the
that
other
work
ministries.
Out?
And so glad you asked the question, right? It ends with Hitler actually consolidating power, not being controlled. The exact opposite happens in Germany. And there's a whole series of events throughout the rest of the year. By June of 1933, you know, there's something called the Night of the Long Knives. And this is where Hitler, the one thing that they gave, not to get too far in the weeds, but the one thing that this coalition gave the Nazis was they made Hermann Göring head of the Prussian police force.
Oh, wow.
Why is that important? Because the Prussian police force are used eventually. They become the Gestapo.
Yep.
And so that becomes the first... And I think it's the Bavarian police later on in 34, 35 that become the premise for the SS. So, so by this political moment, right, of mechanizations of moving things around,
right,
Hitler is able to create the Gestapo. The Gestapo are sent out, and this Night of the Long Knives in mid-1933 is where the Nazis consolidate power by murdering a lot of other key ministers and their families. And then after that, nobody in Germany wants to fight the Nazis anymore. And
yeah,
very
yeah.
quickly, he takes over the country under the premise of you know, we're doing this for the workers. You know, remember, this is a nationalist socialist movement.
Exactly.
Of course, the communists can see right through this, right? They're like, no way.
Yeah.
And so can both liberals and conservatives. But he ends up being able to liquidate the Reichstag and the Weimar Republic. This is the democratic, the parliamentarian government that's installed after World War One and ends by the end of 1933.
And people have to realize that at this point, the United States wouldn't be a part of World War II until 1940 with the bombing of Pearl Harbor. So, I mean, there was still...
Right on, man. Well, and not only that, but in 1933, you have a raging civil war going on in the country of Spain. Oh. Franco would not have been able to... So, again, for people that might not know this, the end of the Spanish Civil War, the result of that is the fascists actually won. And Francisco Franco ruled with an iron fist the country of Spain from whatever it was, 35, 36, until he died in the mid-1970s.
Jeez.
So, he would not have won without three very important things, okay? And this is just good for Americans to understand, for all of us.
Absolutely.
And it puts this movie, Duck Soup, in context.
Oh, absolutely.
Because they definitely knew what was going on. And the Marx Brothers were very... We will get
into the war part in just a second. After
Well, the result, of course, there are three very important things. He had Mussolini's armaments. He had German tanks and planes. But you can't run a war without energy. And it was, in fact, even though FDR had put out official administration edicts that American corporations were to not sell anything to the fascists in Spain.
Right.
Texaco, led by a Norwegian national, actually sold the fuel so that German and Italian tanks and planes would be used.
Yeah.
And so the end result is, after about 2 years, you know, the Spanish Civil War ends with the fascists winning. This is important to Germany and Italy because they kind of turn around. You can just imagine, you know, in Marx Brothers fashion, you know, they kind of turn and like, that we won. Like, you can actually win this shit. And you know, the rest is, as they say, history, but it's just a brutal history.
Oh, Europe, it is. Absolutely.
Europe goes down in a conflagration over the next 15 years.
So, yeah, you kind of see that with the final war scene where they're all, you know, they're all fighting Sylvania. And for the most part of the movie, they seem to be losing. And there's like, and there's another thing that, you know, a lot, you know, history, you know, anybody watching the movie probably noticed right off the bat, you know, Groucho doesn't really care about continuity, because it's like every time the scene changes, he actually changes his costume. So, like, at one point he's wearing like a Civil War costume. The next point he's wearing a Boy Scout uniform. The next...
And he's saying something, right, to the audience with each one of these.
Visually he's saying something, but
that's what I'm saying.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, yeah.
But, you know, it's like, you know, nothing's mentioned. I love that sort of humor. I love the fact, you know, when things are sort of like absurd like that, where they don't really, you know, which, you know, nowadays I suppose is considered Python-esque, but it's something that's really was started by the Marx Brothers with their films.
That's right. Yeah, do you especially feel like the Marx Brothers, they were, I mean, these guys... I think it's unfair to say they're ahead of their time just because they were so popular at their time.
Oh, yeah.
You know, it wasn't like people didn't get it, but they basically set the stage for comedy for the next century.
I don't think people understood it as much then as they did now. So, and I think even, you know, as far as like being a political film, Groucho would kind of dismiss it in an interview, saying, you know, we were just four Jews just trying to get a laugh, you know, his words.
You know, the empathy side of me just tries to deal with the fact that, like, these guys, what was it like to live at that time? To
be
an entertainer, you have what we would now call bandwidth, right? Like, people listen to you, right?
Yeah.
And you're watching this shit go down in Europe. At the same time, though, we have, you know, there's the American Bund, which a couple years after this, you know, they hold a big rally.
Madison Square Garden?
These are American fascists, yeah. There's a big rally at Madison Square Garden in New York. There's this great photograph from that, this juxtaposition of fascism, right, and fascist symbolism, American fascist symbolism. And then what do they have on the stage for everyone to see? On either side of the speakers, they have they literally have portraits of Washington and Lincoln.
That's absurd.
They've twisted this idea of what those two key points in American history represented, how it's supportive of the idea of fascism and consolidating power.
Yeah, exactly.
It's like, how do you do that?
But it shows like just how fragile all political systems really are, right?
And like we said, Duck Soup is definitely a film. You know, you're not getting slammed in the face by politics. You can watch this. You can watch this film. I guess you could watch this film. You could be a Democrat or Republican, and you don't feel like, unless you don't have a sense of humor, you don't feel like you're being attacked.
It's not partisan, right? It's more about fundamental principles, and it just pokes fun. Listen, when you have something as dramatic as like Nazism rising to power, right? You've got to have a good laugh. And actually, we see the power of satire. You like to drive people's, probably more serious decisions and reactions, post the experience of having a good laugh to get things started, right? To get
right.
the discussion going. Unlike, right? You ready for the segue?
I'm ready for the segue.
Unlike The Great Dictator,
which is
1940.
Which, if some of the films like Robert Downey Jr.'s Chaplin are to be believed, and I believe some of it is fact, where he just felt like, his brother Sidney was half Jewish.
Yep.
So he felt like this is a statement he had to make. Because at that time, it was kind of twofold. I mean, Chaplin had been doing silent films up to that point, even when he was doing like City Lights and Modern Times. They had music and they had sound effects, but they were silent films because he felt, he couldn't.
No dialogue.
No dialogue, because he'd feel like that would kill the tramp to like give him a voice.
Right.
So with The Great Dictator, you have this very Prisoner of Zenda's sort of plot, where it's like Chaplin's not only playing the Adolf Hitler character, he's also playing the tramp who's portrayed as a Jewish barber in this
That's
film,
right.
who
That's
ends
right.
up getting mixed up for the dictator. And he felt like, if he was going to have the tramp talk, he at least should give him something he really believed in, and gives the character possibly one of the greatest movie speeches ever.
So that's right. This film is more overt, right?
Oh, absolutely.
It's certainly satirical, but the imagery, the costumes, even the historical context that Chaplin puts the plot in.
And people saying, Hitler stole your look. I mean, now,
right.
It's like, you had like Chaplin or Oliver Hardy with like the toothbrush mustache, and nobody can do that anymore because Hitler ruined it. Thanks, Hitler.
Yeah, exactly. Like none of us can do this anymore.
No,
I'm just trying to look up the name of it's a great example of just how overt he is at directly pointing fingers at Mussolini and Hitler.
I think the last name of the Hitler character was Hank. I can't pronounce I don't remember how the first name is pronounced, but it was Hinkel.
Yeah, Adenoid Hinkel.
That was it.
The Benito Mussolini character, the name is. Who's, by the way, he's leader of the nation of bacteria, is Benzino Napoloni. This film, by the way, at the time
yeah.
that it came out, needless to say, these leaders who, it's clear that they're being made fun of.
Oh, yeah, they're being mocked.
And being mocked. These were definitely banned films in those countries.
Oh, absolutely.
Sure. And of course, not that Chaplin cared about that at all,
Yeah.
This speech you were talking about, I just want to recount, there's a portion in the speech in the beginning of it that's really prescient to our time. So if you'll indulge
absolutely.
Me, I'll just...
Absolutely, go right ahead.
I'll read here, where he says, "Greed has poisoned men's souls, has barricaded the world with hate, has goose-stepped us," he gives that visual, goose-stepped
yep.
us into misery and bloodshed. And here it is. Keep in mind, this is nearly 90 years ago. We have
yeah.
developed speed, but we have shut ourselves in. Machinery that gives abundance has left us in want.
Just stop for a minute, because actually that could really speak for like the internet and stuff like that now.
Completely.
It's, even though it's like given us a larger audience, because here I am speaking to several people
right.
Over the web, it's one of these things, we're set, even though it's like, it's, we can see the big wide world out there, it's also kind of shut us in, where we're all connected to our phones, we're connected to our, our
and yet
Facebooks,
so dislocated from each other, from our, the sense of humanity and a sense of real physical connection.
Exactly, right? I mean, so it's a line that, kind of, when you hear it, it's like, wow, that really hits you.
Well, that's exactly it. And
even now.
And so we've lived through
let's just get real. We've lived through more than a century of rapid change and growth in technologies, yeah. Right? So, you know, in his own context, right, by 1940, if you lived as Chaplin did from the 1890s
yeah.
to 1940, you've seen
Queen Victoria, you've seen
the end of the Victorian era, you've seen the automobile, you've seen mass communication,
both through
cinema and radio, the airplane, and he's saying, you know, we've developed speed. He's literally talking about the speed in which we talk, we yep. think, we travel, the speed in which ideas go from one place to another.
Even back then, he could see this, you know.
And we've continued to live through this throughout the 20th and 21st century, right? Then he says machinery that gives us abundance, right? Wealth has left us in want.
Yep.
A big part of fascism is it is in fact a response to the instability and the greed and the redistribution of wealth after World War I that right. left some countries vastly wealthy and able to rebuild, and other countries, namely Italy and Germany, completely incapable of rebuilding right. themselves and many of the other Axis powers, which led to fascism.
Yep. I was going to say, let them open to people like Adolf Hitler.
He says, he goes on to say, our knowledge has made us cynical, our cleverness hard and unkind. We think too much and we feel too little. More than machinery, we need humanity. More than cleverness, we need kindness and gentleness. Without these qualities, life will be violent and all will be lost. This is just one paragraph in this long speech. And it's incredible, right? It's speaking right to us today.
Like he said, if this was going to be, you know, the final appearance of the tramp, he was at least going to give him something he believed in.
That's right.
I'm sorry, but I don't want to be an emperor. That's not my business. I don't want to rule or conquer anyone. I should like to help everyone if possible. Jew, Gentile, black man, white. We all want to help one another. Human beings are like that. We want to live by each other's happiness, not by each other's misery. We don't want to hate and despise one another. In this world, there's room for everyone, and the good earth is rich and can provide for everyone. The way of life can be free and beautiful, but we have lost the way. Greed has poisoned men's souls, has barricaded the world with hate, has goose-stepped us into misery and bloodshed. We have developed speed, but we have shut ourselves in. Machinery that gives abundance has left us in want. Our knowledge has made us cynical, our cleverness hard and unkind. We think too much and feel too little. More than machinery, we need humanity. More than cleverness, we need kindness and gentleness. Without these qualities, life will be violent and all will be lost. The aeroplane and the radio have brought us closer together. The very nature of these inventions cries out for the goodness in men, cries out for universal brotherhood, for the unity of us all. Even now, my voice is reaching millions throughout the world, millions of despairing men, women, and little children, victims of a system that makes men torture and imprison innocent people. To those who can hear me, I say, do not despair. The misery that is now upon us is but the passing of greed, the bitterness of men who fear the way of human progress. The hate of men will pass and dictators die, and the power they took from the people will return to the people. And so long as men die, liberty will never perish. Soldiers, don't give yourselves to brutes. Men who despise you, enslave you, who regiment your lives, tell you what to do, what to think, and what to feel, who drill you, diet you, treat you like cattle, use you as cannon fodder. Don't give yourselves to these unnatural men, machine men with machine minds and machine hearts. You are not machines. You are not cattle. You are men. You have the love of humanity in your hearts. You don't hate. Only the unloved hate, the unloved and the unnatural. Soldiers, don't fight for slavery. Fight for liberty. In the 17th chapter of St. Luke, it is written, the kingdom of God is within man, not one man nor a group of men, but in all men, in you. You, the people, have the power. The power to create machines, the power to create happiness. You, the people, have the power to make this life free and beautiful, to make this life a wonderful adventure. Then in the name of democracy, let us use that power. Let us all unite. Let us fight for a new world, a decent world, that will give men a chance to work, that will give youth a future and old age a security. By the promise of these things, brutes have risen to power. But they lie. They do not fulfill that promise. They never will. Dictators free themselves.
but they enslave the people. Now let us fight to fulfill that promise. Let us fight to free the world, to do away with national barriers, to do away with greed, with hate and intolerance. Let us fight for a world of reason, a world where science and progress will lead to all men's happiness. Soldiers, in the name of democracy, let us all unite!
It's funny because less than 20 years later, he's kicked out of the United States.
Exactly.
Can you imagine?
Well, I think even back then there were people like J. Edgar Hoover who had, you know, viewed this film as, you know, like being sympathetic towards communism and being it was like ridiculing the United States, where in fact it wasn't. You know, he was ridiculing people like Hitler and Mussolini.
That's
and,
right.
And people who are, you know, as he put it, goose stepping over the globe.
That's right. It's difficult, I think, a lot of times for Americans to just understand that our sort of outlandish or I'll Absolutely. Say inaccurate ideas about communism.
Yeah.
They've manifested themselves over the last 150 years in the United States in various ways that, you know, so, you know, this idea that even though to us, you know, it's like this guy's an anti-fascist. Like, what's wrong with that?
Exactly.
Well, our fears of communism, or let me change that word for just a minute, and then things start to make more sense. Our fear of anti-capitalism.
Yes.
Because we have to remember that the National Socialist German, you know, the party, the Nazi parties are the National Socialists. They're anything right. but a left-wing party, by the way.
Oh, yeah.
But they knew that they could gain popularity by calling themselves this.
Exactly.
But one thing that is socialist in their ideology is that they are consolidating power. They consolidated corporate power, right? Nationalizing major industries,
right?
On behalf of workers, of course. You know, then they killed all the workers.
Yeah.
But there are some...
But of course Hitler thought Henry Ford was the shit.
Well, who's also an anti-Semite.
Exactly.
Right? So you have to get... Let me put it this way. You have to take the labels away.
Right.
And the movement labels particularly away, and the political movement labels away, and just take groups of people or individuals on their own, on their actions, right? And then these things start to make more sense. And the American government, even leading up into World War II, was so afraid of the revolution. Remember, the revolution in Russia is less than 30 years old at this point.
Oh, that's
right
yeah.
It's less than 20 years old. And so so anybody who's sort of, when Charlie Chaplin is speaking out against fascism, he's also speaking out in this speech against technology being used the wrong way,
right.
against the speed at which we consolidate power, and corporate power.
Exactly.
This does not resonate well with big American corporations.
Which he'd already touched upon in his previous film, Modern Times, as
big
well.
Big time. Big time, right?
So it kind of spilled over to this one.
And this is, remember we just mentioned a moment ago, one of these corporations, Texaco, decided, even though FDR told them
yes.
not to sell fuel to fascists. So, you know, large corporations often don't care about political ideology or what's right and wrong. They just want to make money. And so Chaplin always finds himself throughout his career as he's talking about what's right and wrong,
right,
right to him. But that gets him in trouble not only with people who we all feel like, you know, we don't like, but it also gets him in trouble with people that are supposed to be on our side.
Exactly. No, you're absolutely right.
And he becomes a victim of that,
yep.
right? He gets kicked out of the country. He's in Europe for years. They let him back in. This I know very little about,
yeah.
other than to say they let him back in for the Academy Awards.
That was
is that
it,
correct?
Yeah.
Yeah. Did he have to leave after that, or did he stay
I think
here?
He just left after that, because he ended up living the rest of his life in Switzerland. He had a chalet there, which is a really interesting film after his passing, where two people stole the body out of his grave.
I have not seen that movie.
It's called Stealing Chaplin. I've seen a little bit of it. I've been meaning to watch the rest of it, but it is free to watch on places like Roku. Or
that's wild. Is
yeah.
that based on truth?
It is. It's actually based on some actual events.
They tried to steal his.
No, I think they actually stole it. And they eventually were able to, I think they stole it. They were trying to get like a ransom for it. And I think they eventually ended up getting Well, of course, they ended up getting his body back, and I think they ended up like reinforcing his crypt with cement so people couldn't break into it again.
Dude, it's like him and what's her name there? Don't cry for me, Argentina.
Oh, Evita.
Evita, yes, Evita. Eva Perón.
Why, like, did they try to steal her body too?
Well, this is my stream of consciousness getting me in trouble here on this podcast. No, after she died, they preserved her body with a process that had been
formulated. Oh, they did the same formulated. Thing for Lenin.
Yeah, correct. And so, and then for a while, they had to put her body in hiding because everybody wanted her body. Some people wanted to put it on permanent display for the country. Oh. And it's this, it's kind of weird just how we handle corpses.
It really is.
Famous people sometimes.
Well, even Lenoir dealt with that in his book, The Loved One, where it just sort of like especially in the United States, our very strange way of the way we deal with the dead.
Well, I don't think it's just here. I think it's the deification of people.
That's true.
But it gets us into this.
But with us, we have this whole, we have these huge cemeteries like Forest Lawn out in California, yeah. Or even Mount Auburn out this way, that are just like these really amazing edifices, yeah. in places just with all the this great architecture and just, giant trailer parks for dead people.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, I guess it's part of civilization. It's part of our humanity, yeah. is that we want to celebrate people after they're gone, right?
I mean, look at the way they build most mausoleums or crypts. It's a lot of the times they look like somebody's home.
That's right.
In marble or whatever. So, right. It's that, wanting to live past death or something like that.
So you had a great a film that I hadn't readily thought of.
Well, before we mention that,
okay, go.
In the same vein as The Great Dictator, there's also something that's slightly the same as The Great Dictator, but also in a different vein. Was You Nazi Spy with the Three Stooges?
I have not seen that.
It is. It's this is a lot more slapstick, but they also it's also Mo Howard playing the Adolf Hitler character with Larry and Curly as his sort of sidemen.
It has to be hilarious.
Oh, it's hysterical, and not only that, Adolf Hitler actually wanted to kill the Three Stooges after it was made.
Really? That's when you know you've done a good job, yes. In anti-fascist cinema. So, they all want me dead.
Again, Jewish comedians, sticking it to Hitler.
I can't imagine. What year did that come out?
I think that was around, the 19... It had to be sometime after. I don't know if it was before. I can't remember if it was before or after the Great Dictator. I almost want to feel like it was after, sort of where the Great Dictator was a little... It was a comedy, but it was a little more puffed up. It was a little more...
So we're talking though the wartime though, because The Great Dictator is both produced and distributed the year after Hitler's march into Poland. So the war's on in earnest at that point.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? The Americans aren't in it yet, but there's still a war going on.
This is definitely, I think, wartime. You'd have to look that up, but it's like it's one of those things where it was definitely a lot of the cartoons and stuff like that at the time, you had what would be deemed now as propaganda, but it was, sort of rally morale or rally the troops, because, the country's just coming out of around that time, it'd come out of the Great Depression, and it was,
right.
And people were, needed, and people were going, people's husbands and fathers and sons were all going to war. So, you needed something to sort of boost up the morale. And I mean, what better way than to laugh or thumb your nose at Adolf Hitler. And not only that, it's the great thing is to have it really piss him off.
I mean, let's just mention that one of the great things about fascists is...
What, no sense of humor?
The fact that they're so ridiculous.
Yeah.
Even our 21st century fascism that seems to be all the rage here in certain circles in America.
Yes.
It's just so kitsch. I mean, the pop culture around fascism is just so campy.
It's weird.
It's just bad. And it's almost great for satire.
It's almost like they fetishized it.
Well, no, it's 100% that. Yeah. You know what I mean? Taking it back to the World War II era, the way that Hitler, you can say the same thing about radical leftist people too, Stalin, and communism. We're definitely talking about people who take themselves too seriously.
Oh, absolutely. Right?
And the choices about what art is allowed
or not allowed in the country. Now, I don't mean to make light of the fact that political dissidents are almost always artists like you and I.
Right.
You know, like, we're the first to be hung put into a gulag, right?
Yeah.
But while it's happening, and you see, you know, like, just the infantilization of messaging, all of it is just so garish and so ugly.
Well, talk
ugly.
About making it infantile. The one, before we move on from, like, the Great Dictator, there was the one scene where he's taking, like, the giant globe of the world, and he's, like, sort of bouncing it around like a giant beach ball.
Exactly.
And it's just, like, making, like, Hitler look just absolutely like a ridiculous child.
Well, and we have footage of public events and stuff where it is like that almost. You know what I mean? I mean, not literally a beach ball of the globe, but, like, look at most Third Reich. You know, because the other thing is they filmed everything, right? So, like, there's plenty of proof that the Germans were just heading down the wrong road and just, like, but, like, it's the imagery, it's the symbolism, the idolatry is just so campy. It's almost, if it wasn't actually killing millions of people, it would be ridiculous.
I think,
know?
Especially after the war into the 1950s, it was a lot of the times, I mean, I think it was the English or the British who, satirize, you know, Hitler and the Nazis a lot. I think as a kind of a release, having a lot of the performers at the time had fought in World War II. So I think it was like their way to sort of vent about that. I mean, especially in the case of Spike Milligan, who had written, war memoirs, you know, one of them called Adolf Hitler and My Partner's Downfall.
Talk about that a little bit. I didn't realize that. That's interesting.
They were. I'm trying to remember because it was one of those things I'd read them a while ago. But they're really great because it's like his memories of him. You know, it's in sort of a comedic sort of. It's in his sort of comedic sort of way, and you do get a laugh, but you do get a feeling that he went through a lot during World War II, and like he, you know, one of the books he came out, I think it was like called Rommel, Gunner Who, and he mentioned it in an interview, like he'd have like these fantasies, like, you know, a lot of these German officers must have gotten the shakes, which some people need to know what the shakes are,
right,
you know,
right.
Meaning that, you know, you really have to go to the bathroom. So it's like he had this fantasy in his mind of, Hitler running into like this queue of toilets, you know, looking for Rommel. It's like, Rommel, where are you? I'm in here, sir.
Yeah,
he's
that's
like,
awesome.
Come out of here, Rommel. We got something going on out here. We got something going on in here, sir.
The anal retentive fascists.
Oh, absolutely.
Well, you know, I guess it's another characteristic of fascists. They're very uptight people.
Oh, gosh, yeah. Well, some people said, I think Hitler had syphilis, so.
He had a number of different problems, right? He was always on medication and pills. He was obviously a very anxious person. He's on a lot of like.
Obviously, he wasn't on the right pills.
What's that?
Obviously, he wasn't on the right pills.
He wasn't on the right combination of pills, I think. No. And the cowards, all of them. You know, it's this isn't going our way anymore. We're going to kill ourselves.
Yeah.
You know, like, we're not going to stick around to have to, you know, pay for the sins that we've...
And you're coming with me, Eva. Oh, shit.
Oh, my Lord. So, moving on. I'm glad you brought that up, the Three Stooges, because that was a movie. In preparing for this, I wasn't even thinking about that.
I meant to mention something about that.
And like you, growing up, because we both grew up in the same town even.
Absolutely, yep.
Saturdays, Channel 56.
Yep.
I can't imagine that I did not see at least scenes from that movie, but I wouldn't have known at 5, 6 years old when I was watching. I just thought that the gags were funny. And
it had Curly Howard in it, which were always the best Three Stooges shorts, even though I've kind of come around about Shemp in later years, but the ones with Curly were always the best. So you had Mo, Larry, and Curly at the height of their, at the height of their humor.
Right.
You know, basically doing something that's sort of like pseudo political, but not, you know, just basically just giving people, you know, a good lighthearted laugh
and
at
like
a really big
like
jerk.
So many entertainers at that time doing their part for the war effort.
Yep, exactly. You know.
So you brought up another great movie that,
yes.
Again, this is another one that I hadn't readily thought of for this podcast.
And it's something,
only because it's much later.
Exactly.
But it's such a great example of, in this case, American satire in film. We're satirizing really ourselves, right?
Yes.
As opposed to some foreign power. Talk about that.
Yes. Dr. Strangelove, or How I Learned to Stop Worrying and Love the Bomb.
Based on a novel, correct?
I believe so, yes.
Yeah. And starring...
Peter Sellers,
who would have been in more. This is another part of this movie I hadn't known until we started talking about this. He would have been playing more characters.
Yep, he would actually have been playing He would have played the Slim Pickens character as well, the bomber pilot who ends up, who has like the Southern accent, who puts on the cowboy hat and is going to drop the bomb because one of the generals snapped and decided to, I believe it was like some sort of doomsday protocol where they were going to bomb Russia off the map.
Right. So this movie takes place during the Cold War.
Yes.
And we're deep in the we're deep in the midst. I'll provide a little historical context.
Which, yeah, at that point, people were, I can remember my dad talking about, doing, nuclear, atomic bomb drills, ducking under your desk. So
right.
People were very afraid, one of the other country was going to be the one to drop the bomb. I mean, especially after 1945.
Well, and this movie comes out, correct me if I'm wrong, after the Cuban Missile Crisis.
Yes.
And so under Kennedy, we have, you have this juxtaposition under both the Eisenhower and the Kennedy administrations. You have this, domestically, you have this continuation of the New Deal.
Yes.
And of the expansion of opportunity for the middle class. This is arguably the wealthiest time period in American history.
Absolutely.
We come out of the war and the United States dollar is, Bretton Woods 1943, the world decides the world currency by which all of the currencies will be set is the American dollar.
Right.
This is the expansion of suburbia in America. This is when American dollars are plentiful, they're cheap, and we are literally like the only country left in the West.
Yes.
That can still make things and can still produce because everything else has been laid to waste in the war. So we become extremely powerful, extremely wealthy. Kennedy really ups the ante with the communists in Soviet Russia, and we're in the midst of this huge arms race.
Exactly.
And then we almost really screw up the Cuban Missile Crisis.
Oh, absolutely, yeah.
And both sides get, really, really scared. And then, so there's a ton of literary and cinematic satire at this time, right? It's fertile territory for counterculture and for mainstream culture alike to kind of be saying, all of this is in service to kind of question, like, what the hell does this all mean, and where
yeah,
are we going with this?
Absolutely. And at the beginning of the film, you have Peter Sellers as this British, I believe, RAF officer, Group Captain Colonel Mandrake, who ends up going into the office of this General Jack D. Ripper.
Right.
So, you can guess what, the name is, but who has decided that, he wants to, he's going to blow Rush off the map because they're the line was like they were basically had to do our precious bodily fluids with something like that, and they were it was like they were being tarnished.
Yeah, playing to people's innermost fears.
Exactly.
About self violation and how that plays into this greater, more abstract notion of of the entire world coming to an end.
Right? You also have the great George C. Scott, and as
we'd be remiss if we didn't mention.
Oh no,
right?
He ends up playing another character who's kind of gung ho, but not as bad as the Jack D. Ripper character. And again, you have once again Peter Sellers as the president, and I feel like I need to mention the name of his character, President Merkin Muffley,
which is so great.
Yes. For those of you who don't know what that means, you can look it up on Wikipedia. But
look it up on Wikipedia, boys and girls.
I believe Sellers said he based his character, Muffley's character, on Adlai Stevenson, just the way he talked.
Yes.
Because there's the great scene of him on the phone saying, "Now Dimitri, one of our generals, well, he went a little funny, a little funny. And he did a very silly thing. Well, I'll tell you, Dimitri." And it just goes on. And he's like, "No, I don't hate you, Dimitri. Why would I? Why are you getting excited, Dimitri?"
Yeah. It's a great character.
Yeah.
For those that have not seen Peter Sellers, you really owe it to yourself.
Oh, absolutely.
And the thing about this movie is, with all Peter Sellers movies, is now there's great dialogue.
Oh, absolutely, yeah.
The script is excellent.
Directed by Stanley Kubrick.
And it's on top of it, yeah, we didn't even mention that, right?
Yeah.
This is a Kubrick film. So you've got the cinematography, the way that this movie is shot.
And it works really well that it's in black and white.
It works well in black and white, and it's very 1960s, but not in a, to me, there's a lot of that kind of 60s editing that is
especially, you know, a lot of the like hippie oriented movies, it's very timely and doesn't really hold up well. This movie's a classic.
Oh, absolutely.
This is so expertly done. But Peter Sellers, getting back to him.
Yes.
This is a movie, any Peter Sellers movie, you really have to watch.
Yeah.
Because two-thirds of the comedy, and I mean also satire, is in the physical acting by Peter Sellers.
Which brings us to his third and most important character.
Right on.
Dr. Strangelove, which is, you know, you got the name of the movie for.
Right.
Who is this former German scientist who's working with the United States, who I think in the film, because people, when you see the film, he has like this one hand that seems to have a mind of its own. So I think they wanted him to have like a mechanical hand. It was just, you know, sort of gives into his old, you know, he starts like doing a Nazi salute.
Exactly, right? This is why you need to watch the movie. Like, you have to see it. He's always just, you know, almost there to give the fascist salute.
I know.
Kind of saying to us watching the movie that behind, you know, deep down inside, this is strictly my own personal conjecture, but I don't know how you think about this, but do you believe like all evil at the end of the day, or all bad behavior, all truly evil things are, they just sort of, they smell the same, they look the same, and it's kind of making the viewer question, like, you know, here we are in this world, right, where we've beaten off this fascism, and yet we're actually working with like technology, and this is all truth, right? A lot of our rocket technology was developed by Nazi Germany.
Yeah.
And so one of the benefits of winning the war was, oh, we're going to take these professors and we're going to take these researchers and we're going to bring them to, you know, Los Alamos. We're going to bring them to Washington. We're going to bring them to Princeton. We're going to bring, and, you know, which, by the way, there's a lot of academic elite of Germany some of which came before the war, of course, like namely at Princeton, you have Einstein.
Oh, right? Yes. Yep.
Who is luckily, you know, is able to escape Germany and is like horrified by, but after the war, he's horrified in the decades after, you know, like how this technology is being used.
No, and understandably so.
And that's all sort of like with it, to me, that's all deeply symbolic from Dr. Strange.
There's also a lot of very sly scenes in that movie. And one of them, like it sort of builds up like you thinking maybe the United, you know, it's like maybe the, you know, George C. Scott's character is overreacting. Maybe he's being belligerent and stuff like that, and you know him saying, you know, you can't bring the, because they bring in the Russian ambassador, and he's like, you can't bring the Ruskies into the war room, they'll see the big board. And you know, he ends up getting in another great line from the movie. He ends up, him and the Russian ambassador get into a fight, and Peter Sellers' president says, gentlemen, you can't fight in the war room.
Yeah, right.
But there's also, you know, after all this has happened, there's like this scene slipped in where, you know, everybody's backs turned. And the Russian ambassador is making like he's tying his shoe, but he's actually taking pictures of the big board.
Right, right. And there is that that example of like the sort of like making fun of the fact that like all of this, you know, power and technology.
Yes.
So it's infantilized, right? It's like,
yep,
there's nothing behind the big board. It's just a board, right? But like, oh, we can't let them see the big board.
Yeah,
right?
Exactly.
And then, of course, they're eager to take pictures because they think there's something behind this. They're
right.
Like, oh, we're going to figure shit out, you know. It's like, it's just a board, you know. It's just, it's great, you know.
And honestly, the only character that ends up being like the most sanest character in the film is the first character, Captain Mandrake, played by Peter Sellers, who, you know, witnesses the Ripper's descent into madness and just trying, you know. And of course, he's trying to get the, you know, this thick-headed soldier to listen to him because he's got, you know, he's got the you know, the plans to make them stop from bombing Russia. And this guy's just, you know, this soldier's like,
he's not listening.
He's not listening.
And yeah, he kind of comes around, right? He has this catharsis over the movie. That
again,
he realizes, holy shit, like this is going to annihilate it. This is what it really means. We've been talking about this in the abstract, but this is what it really means for this to happen.
Another great line. It was one of these things where, you know, he's trying to get money, you know, change for the phone, and the guy doesn't have change, and he just says, you know, shoot the cola machine, and the guy's like, you know, that's the thick-headed soldier's like, that's destroying public property, and then he basically tells him off, you know, if you don't do that, you know, basically just saying, you know, if you don't do that, you're going to be, you're going to have to deal with a lot more than just destroying public property. He's like, well, if I'm right, you'll have a lot more to deal with than public property. He's like, yeah, well, if you're wrong, you're going to have to answer the Coca-Cola company.
Yeah. So homage to our corporate.
Exactly.
Corporate greed,
yeah.
And that who's really in charge, right?
Yeah.
And you know what's remarkable about that is a lot of us younger Americans today,
yeah,
that have been in the last 10, 20 years dealing with our own brand of trying to assess what kind of power corporate America has over us. Well, this isn't a new thing, and in fact, what we're experiencing today, to me, is the apex of a time period that has been accelerated from really since post-World War II to now.
Absolutely.
Unbroken, right? We even ourselves, as an example, we have friends, obviously a lot of you and I, when we were growing up, a lot of our time period was defined by,
oh yeah,
by the Vietnam War.
Yep.
And, we've got a mutual friend whose father served and had, the short story here is, had really witnessed during the war the fact that corporations, American corporations, U.S.-based corporations were eagerly taking resources out of South Vietnam.
And even around
during this war,
even
that we're supposed to be saving these people.
You had some great, you had the film MASH come out, which was,
yeah,
even though it was about
yeah.
the Korean War, it really was a statement about the Vietnam War.
And of course.
Not talking about the television series, which was actually better than the movie.
Yeah.
But, I'm talking about the one with Donald Sutherland and Elliot Gould.
That's right.
Yep. Which was very much, broken into these vignettes. But, that one, Catch 22, these movies that came out that were just, really kind of making a statement about, the Vietnam War.
I think you've just pointed out another podcast we need to do just about Vietnam War era movies.
Oh, absolutely, yes.
Yeah, MASH is remarkable too. I mean, I know we're talking about movies today.
Yeah.
But it's remarkable because it's a TV series.
Yeah.
So there's that many more people who over a long period of time, end up seeing it.
Oh, absolutely.
And it was such a well-written show that it transcends a time period. Like by the time MASH goes off the air in the early 1980s, in a lot of ways this country is a totally different place.
Yeah, the Korean War lasted a really long time.
Lasted a long time. I can't remember how many seasons, but it had to be
13. No, I meant the actual Korean War.
Oh, the Korean War.
Which didn't last that long.
Oh, no.
No.
It's 48 or 49 through, I think, 52 or something like
something
that.
Something like, it wasn't that long. It wasn't as long as the MASH TV series, let me tell you.
No. Yeah, well, because how many seasons is the MASH TV series?
I feel like it was 1970 to 1983, maybe?
I know it ended in 83.
Yeah.
I just couldn't remember. Yeah.
It's 70, it 71. It was a... It
so was 13 or 14 seasons.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Wow. Yeah, so this is a totally different place.
I know.
Before.
But still, it's one of those things. It's, it's people's react, movies like MASH, it's people's reaction to what, even though it was about the Korean War, it really was kind of a reaction to the Vietnam War and people's
It's the fact that both the screenplay for the movie and the script for the show
based on a book
are taking place in this other time period, which allows for a variety of statements,
which is actually funnier,
or indictments of what's currently happening,
which is actually funnier because I think the original book was very pro-war, whereas the TV series was very much Alan Alda's baby, and it became very much a very anti-war, very liberal political, statement about the world.
Yeah, for sure. I didn't realize that about the book.
Yeah,
it is remarkable, right? But you put this is another, sometime tool of satire is if you take everything you want to say, but you put it in this slightly different context,
yep,
the king won't get upset. It's only when you directly mock the king.
Yeah.
like
we said, fascists just do not have a sense of humor.
And I think the country would have been right time, right place, right? Both for the movie with Elliot Gould and Donald Sutherland,
yeah,
and then later for the TV show, particularly after 1968 and the Tet Offensive, the Vietnam War.
That very much disillusionment.
The disillusionment. I mean, for a lot of Americans, if you weren't anti-war before that, you might not be pro-war. You might not have been a hawk, but you basically were keeping your mind and your heart out of it.
Yeah, exactly.
But after the Tet Offensive in 68... this starts to get a lot harder to do, and the anti-war movement gains even more traction. And throughout the 1970s, of course, the war drags on, and expands under the Nixon administration,
yeah,
with the bombing of Cambodia, the secret bombing of Laos, until 1975. And then, you know, let's just get, you know, our generation can say this, you know, prior generations had a hard time with it, but, you know, we essentially leave there lucky that they're letting us off the hook.
Absolutely.
You know, and even in and of itself, leaving Vietnam in 1975 doesn't go all that well.
No, it doesn't.
I mean, so much of like, of our upbringing, whether we realize it or not, was defined by that. Whether it be people's general apathy to trusting and therefore engaging in American politics, right, even at the local level.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of this comes out of the disparagement that everyone starts to feel between, I mean, if the war didn't do it, Nixon, you know,
oh,
in 74
yeah,
does it. I mean, it's a crazy time.
I am not a butt.
Yeah, exactly, you know.
But actually, looking back at the films we talked about, I mean, it's what amazes me more, especially watching Duck Soup again, watching The Great Dictator, how these movies still, the words still resonate.
Yeah.
They're still very, even though some of the language has changed, you know, over time, and, you know, some of the humor's changed, a lot of it is still topical. It can still resonate with us.
Mentioning
Chaplin's final speech was a perfect example. I just, thinking about it again, it's like, It's still, you know, bullseye today.
And not only now, you make a great point, and I would further that. Not only is it important to us politically, culturally, you know, as a nation, as a group of people, as a community.
Yeah.
But let's not forget that all of the artists and entertainers that, yep, we're talking about, just how genius they were. The Marx Brothers, Chaplin. I mean, he really, throughout his career, was speaking. And, these guys...
Not only that, he went from one film with The Great Dictator doing another controversial film with Monsieur Vidu.
Yes.
Which was one of my favorite Chaplin films.
Yep.
It's an idea he did with Orson Welles about a guy who was, murdering these rich widows in order to sustain his own family.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And it's one of those things where you're like, is he really a villain?
By the way, another time, another place. But
yeah,
a film even more so than The Great Dictator that gets him in trouble with the U.S. government.
Because
it's speaking more directly to class within capitalism.
Another film that had a great line where he's in court in front of everybody, and he's of course being sentenced to death, and he says, you know, it basically says to his enemies, I will see you all very soon.
Yeah. And with that,
yeah,
we could go on forever.
Oh, gosh, yeah.
But it's going to get less and less about anti-fascist films from the 1930s yes, and 40s. So, you know.
Well, one thing we do on the podcast once in a while is we like to find scripts. Some of them are stuff that have been either first drafts of scripts or stuff that, you know, were unproduced.
And this is one of those.
Yeah, this is actually lines from the from Duck Soup that were never used in the film. I ended up having to rewatch it just to make sure it was, you know, I was right. But yeah, they'd completely changed the line. So I don't know what draft this is from, but it's one of those things. I thought the lines were just as good as what ended up on the film.
Yeah.
Also, you can just hear Groucho's voice as he's saying that. You could hear him actually saying the lines, which is, always a good, you know.
I just want to say, how the hell do you edit a Marx Brothers movie?
You don't.
It's all good, so.
A lot of the writers, I think, like George S. Kaufman, who was like Groucho Marx's favorite writer, or R.S. Perlman, who I guess Groucho, I don't remember if it's R.J. or R.S. Perlman, but him and Groucho didn't get along because Groucho felt he had an ego his head was about the size of his desk.
Yeah,
but right. He also wrote quite a few of the great Marx Brothers movies, and they ended up in one of them, I think, said they would breathe a sigh of relief if the brothers actually spoke a line they had written in the script, because Groucho was notorious with ad-libbing.
He's just ad-libbing the whole thing. Yeah, it's genius, isn't it? Can I just say two more things before
we read this?
Where would American cinema be without two very important things? And for that matter, American music and all other culture. First of all, Jewish emigration during the last half of the 19th century and
very
the beginning
true.
Of the 20th century, and then Yiddish theater.
Very
and,
true.
And vaudeville and what that contributed to American vaudeville.
Oh, absolutely.
Because,
yeah.
Like all of this, the timing, the gags, the language play. I mean, so much of this really comes out of Yiddish theater that
came to America. Well, I believe Bret's uncle was actually part of Gallagher and Sheen. I believe he was Sheen.
Really?
Yep.
Wow. So there you go. There's
so, I mean, direct... that was one of the reasons why his... I mean, his mother was like... The Marx Brothers' mother was like the typical stage mother, where I believe she didn't succeed on vaudeville, so she pushed her sons to...
She was like the Joe Jackson of the 1990s.
Just, yeah, just with... Just without, you know, without the abuse, she would. Well, actually, she was. I.
It's yeah, funny that's probably unfair of me for saying that. I'm sorry. I'm sorry, the Marx Brothers.
But in a sense, it was like Chico was the favorite. Groucho was not her favorite.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and Chico was the one who was kind of the crook in the family. He was the one who was always in gambling debt. He was always in trouble. Yeah. But for some reason, wow. He was the favorite. Whereas Groucho, who I think spent most of his adult life just trying to please his mother, never really did. I'd read a great. Biography on Groucho, like a couple decades ago, that was really just called I think it was called Groucho, The Life and Times of Julius Henry Marx, which I highly recommend people picking up, as well as his biography, Groucho and Me. And I think he did one called, Stories from a Mangy Lover, something like that.
Oh, wow. Cool.
But also...
we got to put that stuff on the podcast.
Oh, absolutely.
Page.
And another one, Chaplin's biography. My autobiography is a very good read, although it's a bit more pompous and a bit more... You never really get to know the real Chaplin in it. Even though in Groucho's, you never really get to... He's still quipping and doing his Groucho-isms. I feel like it seems a little more... A bit more... down to earth than
Chaplin.
You wonder
if it's just, he's a lot more guard. A Chaplin is a lot more simply guarded because
I believe so.
Because of the last 30 years away of his life, the way he was treated.
Actually, that's kind of the thing. The recent documentary, I think, that came out about him said is he never really, even with his own family, he was always kind of guarded about his own personality.
Mom issues, man. Right? Yeah. I mean, he had a really tumultuous relationship with his poor mother, and yeah, it's crazy. Well, anyways, let's read this script.
All right. So this, cool. Mentioning to the listeners, this is actually a unused dialogue from the movie Duck Soup, and there's a great scene which Groucho calls a character, Chico Marx's character up, creatively named Chicolini, because he's selling peanuts outside. The house.
It's actually one of the big scenes from the movie because it moves the plot right along.
It's a hysterical scene, and it's another one of those scenes because that's another thing about a lot of the early Marx Brothers films. Even some of the ones with like Night of the Opera is you had these great, back and forth scenes with, Groucho's quipping, Chico's mangling of the English language or, just sort of turning a phrase.
Yeah, that's right.
So, and this is one
I'm
going
to do my best to do an Italian. Excellent.
Give it what you got.
Hello. Yes, he is not in. That was for you.
I'm sorry I'm not in. I wanted to have a long talk with you. Now look here, my good man. You've got to stop yelling peanuts in front of the House of Representatives.
Oh, no, I can't do it.
You don't want to be a public nuisance, do you?
Sure. How much does the job pay?
You wouldn't consider going over Niagara Falls without a barrel.
It's no good. I went to Niagara Falls once.
Did you shoot the rapids?
No, but I shot some ducks.
If there's an open season for fellows like you, I'll get myself a hunting license. Anyways, I'm going to make you a sporting proposition. You give up the peanut stand, and I'll make you vice president of the country.
Oh, no. Nothing doing. I had a brother once who was a vice president once, and that's the last we ever heard of him.
Well, maybe he's still vice president. Now, if I were to offer you...
Hello? Yes. No. No, not yet. All right. Okay, goodbye. That was for you again. He wants you to call him up as soon as you get back.
I know what's keeping me. I should have been back a long time ago. Now, how about my proposition?
What other job you got?
Let's see. What have I got in my cabinet besides mice? I got it. How would you like to be Secretary of the Interior?
That's no good. I like to work on the outside. I must have something easy.
Then you don't want to work hard?
I don't want to work at all.
In that case, I'll have you take a civil service examination. If you pass, I'll put you in the post office. Stick out your tongue.
I don't want to stick out my tongue.
Well, if you want to work in the post office, you'll have to stick out your tongue.
Look, I'm a very nervous man. I go to have a job when I come to work at 11, go to lunch at 12, and quit at 1. And twice a year, I go to have a 6-month vacation.
I got just the job for you. Secretary of War.
Oh, that's a fine.
So that's a phone conversation they were having.
That's
what they sell, selling peanuts.
Yeah, it's one of those things. The running gag throughout the whole thing was every time the phone would ring, you know, Chico would be like, hello, hello? No, he's not in. I'll tell him. Goodbye. That was for you. I don't know what became of me. I should have been back an hour ago.
That's great. Well, you know, listen, man, this has just been fantastic.
Oh, yeah.
Thanks for having me on.
Oh, you're very welcome. Thank you for having the podcast on as part of your family of podcasts.
You know, I mean, it's so great to have this podcast, Mental Suppository, on our roster because we get to do cool stuff like this.
Oh, absolutely.
Not that all the other stuff we don't do isn't cool, but especially, you know, we've got the political podcast and we've got, you know, ones dealing with economics and culture and stuff. It's all those very serious stuff.
I know.
Right?
You know, and you need a good laugh.
Good to just laugh.
Exactly. And hopefully that's what we give people, a good laugh or a groan.
That's right.
Or both.
At least. At least if you, you know, groan or, you know, feel a little bit of, you know, wincy pain. Not really.
As long as you listen.
As long as you listen. That's right.
You don't have to like us. Just listen to us.
We will now pause for station identification. This is NUTS.
When you hear the conch on the dome, it'll be 3 o'clock, Bologna watch time.
3 o'clock, Bologna watch time.
3 o'clock, Bologna watch time.
It must be 3 o'clock.
On behalf of Scott, thank you for listening to the Mental Suppository. Until next time, this is Bret Herholtz saying,
Monsieur has unlocked!
The Mental Suppository has been produced by Bret Herholtz and Jamie Billings and distributed by M the Media Project. Theme music generously donated by Mr. B, the Gentleman Rhymer. Visit his webpage at gentlemanrhymer.com. We would love to hear from our fans. Email us at mentalsuppository@gmail.com.